Good evening, everybody. This is the College of Complexes. So have a seat and can yourselves down. We are about to hear from our speaker tonight, Dan Weinberg. Daniel,
thanks.
Is a librarian, and he's going to tell us how capitalism was built in the United States of America, particularly referring to a recent book by Sven Beckert on the 1780 to 1850 development of industry and commerce in the United States, and how it was based on cotton. The Empire of Cotton is the name of the book by Sven Beckert.
My fellow Americans.
Thanks, Brown. That was great.
Well, it was short. Rousing introduction.
For an introduction. I just want to thank some people before I start.
Make it short.
I want to thank my wife, of course, and of course, two people who helped me write this, Alvin Grossman, who's here, Fred Major, and Beth Maas, who helped me work on the talk. Thanks to them. I brought some cotton here, if anybody wants to feel it, see it, look at it. This is raw cotton from cottonman.com on the internet. Somewhere in South Carolina, he has a cotton plantation and he sells it all over the world. And he also sells small, want to feel the cotton, take a grip. You can have some. Not all that, Ted. I want it back. Okay, go pass it around, sure.
Anybody
want to
feel it?
And this is a replica of a cotton bale. They're about 480 pounds of cotton, and they're all smashed together. And this is very small of a cotton bale. And I remember things. I see on the schedule that on May 14th, there's going to be a speaker from the Chicago chapter of Veterans for Peace about education, not militarization. And he's against all wars. And he was a former Army Ranger. Anyway, so let's start, Tim.
I got it up.
Okay, so the Empire of Cotton. Actually, I don't have the book today. I have Midnight Rising by Tony Horowitz, and A People's History of the United States by Howard Zinn. And I'm sure you can get them in your local library, public library, or Barnes & Noble. Midnight Rising is about John Brown. Okay, so is it brutal or civilized? Did the American society come about by brutality, slavery, and war? Or did it come about by a bunch of smart people sitting around having a meal and deciding where to put their money? That's my question. Okay. So, history at the College of Complexes. Most talks are about current events like atomic power, thorium power, solar power, police brutality, assassination of presidents, 9/11. But I'm going to talk about something a little older than that. The past is never dead. It is not even past. That's what William Faulkner said. The past is, I like history, and the past is always with you, or with me. I mean, from the time of Romans and Greeks to later on.
How we see, okay, go ahead. So war?
Slavery. War, slavery, and brutality. Plus genocide equals the start of capitalism. Beginning push of the United States. So when, in 1619, when the pilgrims came to America, they found people here. There were Indians here. And they had to move them out to live. Tim, if you want to go to the very end of the talk, try to end. There's some pictures. Yeah, go to the beginning of the pictures. There are about 10 pictures. One or two more. Yeah, a couple more. Not a picture. All right, that's the first picture. This one. It's about 1860. Can you get that one?
I'm getting it right now.
Okay, thanks. Well, anyways, this is Memphis, Tennessee. I went down there to go to the Cotton Museum. And this is the waterfront. They have some scenic, this is the Mississippi River. And they have some boats there that you can take a ride on. And it's downtown Memphis. Very nice, scenic place. Next. This is more Memphis, downtown Memphis. You can see it from like the public library and the Cotton Exchange. There's an old Cotton Exchange building there. Can you go back there? This one. First one. Yeah. Okay. So the USA economy in 1860. The slave population was worth $3 billion. And slaves were used as collateral in bank loans in London and New York. Huh? What?
Nothing. I was just telling a waitress I was ready to order.
Okay. All right, so slaves were used as bank loans in New York and London for money loans that the Southern planters would get. So you know, the bankers in New York would get paid by the banks, and they would get paid by the interest on the loans to the South. And this was a very lucrative business. What else?
Capital investors, $1 billion. I don't know if you can see it. I can barely see it. Livestock, something million. The cotton crop. $250 million. $91,000. Expenditures of the federal government was what? Not that much.
$63 million. So the money from the cotton was more than the government even spent. Or the money from the, I can't see it. Yeah. So the cotton was very profitable for the government, and so when the South wanted to secede, and then some people would have said, oh fine, let them go, they can have their own country, but the North said, no, we want that money, we want that cotton that we make so much money from. So the North fought back, and the North eventually won the war. And many people died, and it was the biggest war in America, that most casualties, a lot more than Iraq or Afghanistan. And if you look on the website, www.sonsofveteransofconfederacy.org, SVC, I think it's some SDVC.org. They still are fighting the civil war, the war between the states. It's a very popular thing. All right.
Next.
Where do you want me to go?
Go to the Sons of Confederate Veterans, the website. SVC. No, it's just SVC letters, initials. Or, it's not org. Vacuum coders, no. www.
What is it called? The Sons of Veterans Confederate?
Yeah, SVC. Or SCV. Maybe SCV. Confederate Veterans. Sorry. No, it's SC. It's just the letters. There it is. There it is.
SCV.
SCV, right. So, they have a court case now in Texas. They sued the government because they wanted to have a rebel flag on the license plate of cars. And it went all the way to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court finally said that they cannot have the rebel flag on the... the state of Texas has the right to deny that organization the rebel flag on the license plate. So, you know, never end.
Back to your PowerPoint?
Yeah. Yes.
Where we're at?
We'll take some more
pictures. Next one?
Next Memphis. That's another Memphis. This is a Ku Klux Klan family, maybe in the 60s, middle 60s. If you go to the next picture, they're holding, it's a mother and father holding hands and a little girl. I'm touching. So, I mean, in some towns, there were a third of the population was a member of the Ku Klux Klan all over the U.S. It was very popular in the 20s. They had a big march in Washington, D.C. with thousands of Ku Klux Klan people. And it finally ended when the president of the Ku Klux Klan in Indiana was arrested and put in prison for some crazy thing he did. Next. This is a wool tree. A lot of people didn't know in the 1700s how wool was came from sheep. So they thought that a tree was gave wool, which is kind of funny. Some people in America, Charlie. This is a picture from the cotton exchange in Memphis that I took. It's some of the companies, names of people who made money trading the cotton. It's something like the Merck or the CBOE in Chicago. They had a big floor and people trading each other, thousands of contracts. The cotton went all over the world, China, India, Russia. In 1860, America was giving, before the war started, the Civil War, America was giving a large percentage of the world's cotton, was shipping a lot of the world's cotton all over the world.
Thank you.
Go ahead, next. Another Memphis.
Next.
This is the cotton. This is a picture of a slave ship in the 1800s.
basic slave ship. Next. This is housing, maybe 1965 in the South. It was a picture in the cotton exchange that I took a picture of. This is picking cotton and a picture from the cotton exchange and people picking cotton. Next. And this is cotton weighing probably in the maybe 50s or the 60s.
Loading.
No, they're weighing it. This person is weighing it to see how much they get paid. They're paid by how many pounds of cotton they have in these bags. It's hard work. This is a modern, maybe 2010, cotton picking machines. Now they do it. So capitalism is great.
This is Calvin Turley.
He's a cotton trader. He's one of the last cotton traders in the cotton exchange. And these are two farmers from, I think, Beaumont, Texas, who came to visit the cotton exchange the same day I was there. I was there in November, just a couple months, 2 months ago. And this is a sign by Fred Major, who's a leader of a protest that's every Saturday from 2 to 4 that I sometimes go to. And he's a white guy who was affected by racism in Chicago. And he's been standing out there with this sign and other signs for the last 14 years. Really? Next. And this is a picture of Jesse Jackson on Black Friday that I took the day after Thanksgiving a couple months ago. Almost 2 months ago, less than 2 months ago, and he looks a little angry, not too happy. Anyway, so let's go to the front. Let's go to the beginning again, and I'll go through some of the boring stuff.
There you go.
All right.
Yeah, that's where you were at before.
All right. We went through this. So it's exploitation, basically. Why are wars fought in the first place? They're fought over boundaries, they're fought over colonies, they're fought over spheres of influence. Why did Germany fight France in World War II? Because of Hitler? Hitler wanted to take over the world? Well, he wanted to see new markets for his Volkswagen. He wanted to enslave the people of the world, so they worked for Germany, basically. So fights over old markets, new markets, like fighting over Iraq or Afghanistan. They're just fighting over pipeline places or fighting over the oil, protecting their market. Protecting the market for oil in America and just sort of defending America's pipeline to oil in the Middle East. Africa, Middle East, and Balkans, those are new markets.
Frederick Douglass said this, the whole history of progress of human liberty shows that concessions yet made to our august claims have been a struggle. There's no struggle, there's no progress. Those who profess to favor
freedom and yet depreciate agitation are men who want crops without plowing the ground. They want rain without thunder and lightning.
So, struggle. History is a constant struggle. I guess Marx said that too. Civil War myths. Okay, some myths that the Civil War was actually a war of northern aggression started by the North to financially exploit the South. Of course, the South attacked the North because they wanted to keep slavery and they wanted to be free of the North. But they were, financially, they were tied to the North by selling their cotton to the North and selling their cotton to England and other places. And they were also tied by the banks. So capitalism grew the country, but there was a price to pay. Next. The South was actually in the process of outlawing slavery before the war began. This was a myth. There were something like 4 million slaves in the South in 1860, who were doing a lot of work and not being paid. And this would have probably continued had the South won the war. Few Southerners actually owned slaves, except the very wealthy. And it wasn't much of a problem. This is true. Most Southerners did not own slaves, but there were still 4 million slaves in the South in 1860. And General Grant was a big slave owner. That's a myth also. He did not own any slaves during the war. He was given a slave by his father-in-law, and he set him free as soon as he could. Next.
You okay, Doug?
Lincoln never intended to free any slaves. He was a racist, and he didn't care about, all he cared about was the money. That was partly true. Except he did do the Emancipation Proclamation, and he did any slave that joined the Union Army was free automatically. And the CSA, the Confederate States of America Army, was a multinational, multi-ethnic group. That's not quite true. The slaves that were in it were forced, quote unquote, forced to be in the army, and if they escaped from the Confederate States, some would join the Union Army and they would fight in that army. Okay, go ahead. So there's a saying in the North: you love the race and you
hate the individual. In the South, we hate the race and love the person.
So there's racism everywhere, and it's true. And these sayings are kind of true, but that's the way it is. Next. All right, Haiti was an important example of what happened when slaves rebelled. Let me get some. So, slaves rebelled in 1797 in Haiti, and they took over the country eventually. And because of this, France imposed a reparations on them, a bill that eventually they didn't finish paying until 1949, almost 200 years later. And this was typical of the winning group. During the war, and
okay.
All right, next.
So the French demanded that Haiti give back the money that they owed, and this continued.
Okay.
Eventually, Haiti was ruled by the Duvalier group, and anyway, so this corruption was bad for Haiti. Next. Last year, former President Bill Clinton apologized for ruining or helping to ruin Haiti's economy. I know this is off the subject, but it goes back to capitalism. I mean, if capitalism is so great, why does it have to punish people who go against the rules?
Next.
Let me just tell the story about Clinton. Clinton came from Arkansas, and he grew a lot. In Arkansas, they grow a lot of rice, and they eventually shipped a lot of rice to Haiti, which destroyed the, and they were selling the rice at a lower price than Haiti's homegrown rice, which was great for the capitalists in Arkansas, in America, but it helped destroy the economy of Haiti, which, you know, capitalists might say, oh, well, that's the way the ball bounces. But you're supposed to be a little human in your dealings with economies and the world governments. Next. This is a talk about Haiti. It's at a university somewhere. Why is Haiti poor?
What's poor?
What?
Nothing, please.
Go on. Next. John Conyers, the U.S. representative from Detroit, gave, in 1999, had H.R. 40, House of Representatives 40. It was a bill for reparations for the Civil War. People might say that it's too late to give reparations for the Civil War, for slavery. And there's some controversy about that, and there's some court cases that occasionally come up. But every once in a while, somebody like Conyers gives a bill to try and do that. Next.
This is H.R. 40.
You can read it on the internet. The whole thing is still there. The idea of Haiti and slaves rebelling and overpowering their white masters scared white people in the South, or some certain slaveholders. So they didn't want the slaves to read or write, or some of them. And it was voting was made very difficult, generally speaking. Anyway, next. Iraq Veterans Against the War. Next. So cotton was first in the world. It was the first worldwide commodity that America was involved in. England. And of course, later there was corn and steel, chemicals, coal, soybeans, oil, and cars, which were also worldwide commodities that were made in every country, made in many countries. Go ahead.
This is a map of Texas. The people, 1845, Texas, of course, was taken over by the United, by the U.S. when they invaded Mexico, and the eastern part of Texas became a very big cotton growing area, and eventually Texas grew the most cotton in the United States, and actually they grow the most right now. They're the biggest cotton growers in the United States. Slavery. So somebody once figured out that slavery cost was worth $3 trillion. Of course, there were no pensions given for slavery. It pretty much guaranteed perpetual poverty. And like I said before, slaves were used as collateral for loans. And there was a kind of schizophrenic country with no slavery in the north and slavery in the south. But of course, there were a few slaves running around in New York, Illinois, Ohio, places like that. So slavery was in what, South Carolina, North Carolina. Then when America bought the Louisiana Purchase, they were moved to the Mississippi River. And when America bought Florida, there was cotton started to be grown in Florida, and slaves were brought to Florida. And the same with eastern Texas. Like I said, Mexican-American War, Florida, and the Louisiana Purchase. So basically, when Columbus came to America, somebody once said he started 300 years of genocide, which I have some numbers of people, number of people killed in Mexico, and Peru, and America. Go ahead, turn. Native Americans were moved to make way for cotton. Were moved basically so people could live there. And you could say that's capitalism. You could say that's just people moving west, progress. And maybe that's the only way people can live. I don't know. Go ahead. That's some of the sons of Confederate veterans were included the president, two presidents, Woodrow Wilson and Truman. Clint Eastwood is a son of Confederate veterans, and so is Pat Buchanan, the great Republican. This is another sign from the protest currently in Logan Square on Saturdays. So the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850 was a concession to the southern states as opposed to letting California in as a free state. Just like Social Security was given to people, but as a concession to the southern senators, no home workers and no farm workers were covered by Social Security, because that was blacks and Mexicans did that kind of work, and the southerners didn't want to cover them exactly. So they didn't. So they didn't work covered. Next. 1% owes us. I took a picture of a sign at a protest. Next. called?
Why the Civil War? Because of capitalism. You could say it was because of capitalism. And maybe it was. Next. Go ahead and turn. You want to read that?
I have a Lincoln and Slavery in 1861. In its inaugural address in March of 1861, I have no purpose, directly or indirectly, to interfere with the institution of slavery in the states where it exists. I believe I have no lawful right to do so, and I have no inclination to do so. With a little note, 4 million slaves in the South in 1860.
So this was before the Civil War started. So obviously he changed his philosophy a little bit, yeah, and he eventually freed the slaves. But he obviously thought differently before. Next. So John Brown. I went to the Chicago History Museum, and they have some John Brown material. They have his original Bible and other things. I didn't see them, they're in the vault. But I saw copies of his writing.
I'm going to read that second statement.
Yeah.
Statement after the capture of John Brown at Harper's Ferry. You had better, all you people of the South, prepare yourselves for the settlement of this question. You may dispose of me very easily. I am nearly disposed of now, but this question is still to be settled. This Negro question, I mean. The end of that is not yet.
So
still not yet.
Right. He was injured at, this is his statement at Harper's Ferry. Go ahead.
The last written statement in prison before he was hanged. I, John Brown, am certain that the crimes of this guilty land will never be purged away, blood with blood.
He was. It was a personal thing with John Brown. I think some people think he's a hero. Some people think he's just a common criminal. Charlie.
Well, he paid.
Huh?
He paid.
Paid with his life. Yeah, he was hung. Two of his sons died at Harper's Ferry. Next. Go ahead. So I copied, I went into the Chicago Public Library and I Xeroxed, I looked at the microfilm for the Tribune and the New York Times for Harper's Ferry and see how they would play it, how it played in the journalism of the time in 1859. So the New York Times had a little bit more material than the Chicago Tribune. So this is, I think this is a announcement of treason. You want to read it?
Pamphlet, treason. All true Christians who believe in immorality through Jesus Christ alone are requested to pay for Captain John Brown, who now is under sentence of death and is to be hung next month for righteousness' sake and doing justly with his fellow man, his country, and his God. By request of one who serves the truth and feels for the man that it is a martyr, to die a martyr to it.
He knew he was a martyr. To a certain extent. Go ahead. I have some headlines somewhere. They're coming up. I, John Brown.
Okay. I, John Brown, am now guilty, am now quite certain that the crimes of this guilty land will never be purged away but with blood. I had, as I now think, vainly flattered myself that without very much bloodshed, it might be done.
The Chicago History Museum on Clark and North Avenue. the library. All right, so these are some headlines from the New York Times. Want to read it?
It's okay, we can see it. Okay. The Harper's Ferry Rebellion.
So they called it a rebellion, and we call it today, what do we call it?
An insurrection.
No, we call it Harper's Ferry, John Brown's...
Raid.
Right, it's like a raid. They call it insurrection, they call it rebellion. It's a little more dramatic than a raid. A raid sounds like you're raiding the refrigerator or something.
That 59 up there, that's 1859,
right.
Isn't it?
1859.
It was an armory, he was stealing weapons to have a rebellion.
That's right. That's
so
right.
That's accurate.
Right, that's accurate. But raid is not accurate.
He had a raid on an armory. Yeah. Or weapons.
It was right. An arsenal. Yes.
Right.
Okay.
It's okay, next. Insurrection. The Negro insurrection,
origins and objects of the plot. And there's more. Captain Brown of Kansas, originator of the disturbance.
Yeah. Insurrection.
Basically, he's saying here, the federal arsenal at Harper's Ferry in possession of the insurgents and a general stampede of slaves.
So, cotton fueled the growth of America. There was so much money stuck in those banks in New York and London that there was money for building up oil business, car business, steel business. It was a capitalistic holiday. There was so much money laying around. And it was all built on the war and slavery and brutality. Next. Economics 101. The rich get richer and the poor get poorer.
That hasn't changed.
So, actually, Texas, as I said, is the biggest, they like 6 million bales of cotton they grew in 2013. And I think Georgia was second with 2 million bales. And then a bunch of states grew a million bales, a million of these things, and California, Arizona, New Mexico. So it's still being built, it's still being grown, and there's a lot of course you got the subsidies from the government, which helped the capitalists a lot, and to keep the capitalists' pockets filled with money, which is good. It's good for the country, right?
Good for the capitalists.
But if you gotta work every day, then that's something else. So I multiplied 480 times 6 million bales. I think that's right, 2 billion pounds, 880 million pounds of cotton grown in 2013. Next. Cotton subsidies, $35 billion in 15 years. That's pretty good. Pretty good amount of money. Supported by Democrats and Republicans. It's all big government. Where's little government? Where's the Republican little government? They're giving $35 billion to the cotton growers. I mean, that's just one crop.
It's such a vital crop.
Yes, it is. Get your clothes and everything. World capitalism. As I said, that Sven Beckert, who wrote this book, Empire of Cotton, he calls it war capitalism, where early in the time, like 1790 to 1830, 1840, when Florida, Texas, and the Indians were getting wiped out. So that was war capitalism to Becker. And That's what he thought. That's what he called it. Next. Never mind. Next. Pope apologized. Want to read this?
The Pope apologized for Catholic genocide of the Native Americans. On July 10th, 2015, at 7:44:05 p.m. But the question is whether his apology is enough to forgive these crimes or not. When the conquistadors first arrived in the Caribbean islands, there were 3 million natives living there. After 50 years, there were just 500 of them left.
So that's a lot of murder.
In Mexico, the population declined from 30 million in 1519 to 1.4 million in 1595. Peru had a population of 25 million. When the conquistadors first arrived, it was reduced to 1 million.
That's a lot of murder. So the Emancipation Proclamation.
On the first day in January AD 1863, all persons held of slaves within any state or designated part of a state, the people whereof shall be then in rebellion against the United States shall be then thenceforward and forever free.
All right, so this is a bank. I don't know if you want to read that. It's one of the big banks that made money in the 1800s. Want to read it? Go ahead.
Bearings traces its origins to 1792, when it was established in London as a firm for merchants and merchant bankers. In the years following, the firm dominated the London capital market to the extent that First Minister of France, the Duc de Richelieu, famously called it one of the six great powers of Europe, along with Britain, France, Russia, Prussia, and Australia.
Austria.
Nothing is said about slavery and loans to buy slaves. Why is that left out?
Right. Triangle shirtwaist fire. That's something about kind.
The Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire in Manhattan, New York City on March 25th, 1911 was the deadliest industrial disaster in the history of the city and one of the deadliest in U.S. history. The fire caused the deaths of 146 garment workers, 123 women, and 23 men who died from the fire, smoke inhalation, or falling or jumping to their deaths. Most of the victims were recent Jewish and Italian immigrant women aged 16 to 23.
This is a lady in the cotton field. Next.
Next.
Yeah. Slaves. So, who here would be for giving reparations for slavery? 2, 3, 4. Okay, I see. It's a minority. That's okay.
And that's in this room.
9/11 conspiracy versus slavery, which is more real.
What?
To the then slaveholders who property was liberated.
To the slaves, former slaves.
You have to make that clear.
Okay. And 9/11 conspiracy. Or slave versus slavery, which is more real?
Oh,
it's a trick question. Okay, next. Cotton field. Beautiful cotton field. Next.
Laws limiting child labor in factories to children older than 8 years old in France in 1941 or 10 years old in the mines in Britain in 1842.
Right. So that was capitalism. It allowed child labor, which, you know, at its time was very useful. Now
that they're not working, generally they allowed child labor.
Yeah.
A quote from the Fugitive Slave Act He is a great slaveholder that has 1,000 slaves, but if this law, the Fugitive Slave Act, is a true exponent of the Constitution, this government ordained for justice and liberty holds 4 million of slaves, sir, the U.S. District Judge. The world has never furnished so great a congregation of hypocrites as those who form the Constitution if they designated to make it the greatest slaveholder, slave breeder, and slave catcher on earth. This was John Hasek in a speech to the U.S. District Court in 1863, and the source was the Newberry Library.
I went to the Newberry Library also. Cotton was half of all U.S. exports from 1830 to 1860. The tariffs supported the government.
Between 50 to 90% of the federal budget between 1790 and 1860.
Right.
Cotton was still big until the 1930s in the USA.
Right. And then other things, steel, oil, got bigger.
Recently, a gentleman by the name of Beckert has at least 270 pages up to the Civil War, and then 170 pages up to today. I would say that he is stronger in his research and history part of Cotton. He did mucho research in England, India, Brazil, Germany, and other places using records and archives for various cotton groups, including growers, planters, loom owners, banks, lenders, etc. Beckert gave a talk at the Cotton Museum in Memphis.
Beckert. Right. So Cotton had been big in Memphis, Tennessee, thanks to slavery, as recent as 5 years ago. Now the biggest companies are not cotton traders, not anymore. Times are changing. Next.
Poet John Greenleaf Whittier called cotton the hashish of the West.
Anyways,
the world is a solidarity and the cause of America is a cause of liberty. America disencumbered of slavery will be a country of all ardent spirits, of all generous hearts. But should liberty become eclipsed in the new world, it will become night in Europe, and we will see the work of Washington, of the Franklins, spit upon and trampled underfoot by the whole school who believes only in violence and in success. It was the intro to The Cause of All Nations by Doyle.
He wrote about how people in other countries saw the Civil War.
In 1863 at Liverpool, the Beatles said, "I want to hold your hand," and the Liverpool Cotton Exchange sells its furniture and closes.
So the cotton business in England was dying very well, dying in 1963. Did slavery cause the Civil War? I don't think so. Slavery didn't cause the Civil War. The cotton business is what the North fought for, and that slavery was just a side issue, a big side issue, but it was a side issue. But I mean, not for the slaves; it was a major thing.
The moment of crisis in 1865. The Civil War was a moment of crisis for the Empire of Cotton.
Moment.
It was also a rehearsal for its reconstruction, as they, the capitalists and the government, surveyed the ashes of the South, they saw promising new levels that might move the mountain of free labor into cotton cultivation with new lands, new labor relations, and new connections between them.
So cotton was, sharecropping was started, and laws were passed.
The Liverpools for the South. Liverpool, where the Beatles from, was the world's largest cotton port, was the most pro-Confederate place in the world outside of the Confederacy itself. Liverpool merchants helped bring out cotton from ports blockaded by the Union Navy, built warships for the Confederacy, and supplied the South with military equipment and credit. The Liverpool Southern Club, as well as the Central Association for the Recognition of Confederate States, agitated for permanent separation.
Okay, next.
Slavery's importance. The system of slave labor was not to be safely trusted. The dread of a slave insurrection and civil discord is what they feared. And this is from the Cotton Supply Reporter, 1861.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a slave auction in Virginia.
England would topple headlong to carry the whole civilized world with her if slavery was threatened. No power on earth dares to make war upon it. Slavery and cotton. Cotton is king. In the 1860s, the cotton's world stature, 1/60th of the people alive at the time were involved in the growing, selling, sowing, processing, and or selling of cotton. Between 1/4 and the 1/5 of the population on earth was involved in cotton.
This is a picture of the dock in New Orleans.
Beckert says that the USA from 1830 to 1860 has both war capitalism and industrial capitalism, and that two were incompatible. Maybe Beckert means that the North depended on cotton too much as a source of taxes and profit to allow the South to secede. In Manchester, England, cotton merchants asked the government to protect ships in the Atlantic from pirates and called for a large naval force.
So the capitalists wanted a navy and an army to protect their interests. And that's what the government was for, to protect their interests.
It got to the point where they had Confederate cotton bonds, where hard-nosed investors in Europe were betting on the success of the Confederacy. The Confederate bond, cotton bonds, are oversubscribed within a day of their initial offering and continued in the on March of 1863 and continued into July, selling near their opening price at about 90%. In the late 1850s, cotton was 70% of British was cotton, 90% of France, 62% of Germany, and 92% of Russia, and that was the percentage of cotton from the USA used in each country.
Nice. So the cotton from America went to these different countries.
When there is no intelligent population to lead the way, a government must do what a more civilized country can safely be left to private enterprise, said by a British capitalist about India's cotton production. Between 1870 and 1800, output of cotton textiles grew annually by 10.8% and exports by 14%. Already there were approximately 900 cotton factories. Brown Brothers Harriman was established in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania in 1818. Through strategic investments and innovative business decisions, we have transitioned from the leaders in merchant banking and transatlantic trade to an integrated worldwide financial services firm. We honor our past and we try to learn from it. But in the day-to-day management of our business, we try to exercise enlightened opportunism because we are not beholden to stockholders. We try to take the long view and do what is better for our clients in the partnership. In other words, no slavery. In the flush times of the early 1830s, Brown Brothers made profits of more than $400 million per year, enough to buy 13 100-foot yachts or 1,300 carriages, horses. $400 million then is worth about $8.3 million today. Why do they leave out slavery help the Brown Brothers get rich? In 1863, England, hard-nosed investors in Europe were peddling heavily on the Confederacy. The Confederate bonds were oversubscribed within a day. Okay, well, we did that one already.
I think this is a double, too. These are the books I used, Beckert's Empire of Cotton. And there was a report by Beckert and his students about Harvard, the Harvard Slavery Research Seminar, and that talked about Harvard and their relationship to slavery and slavery owners who went to Harvard, who were students at Harvard, and the money they got from slavery. And then Doyle, The Cause of All Nations, which is about Civil War and how other countries looked at the Civil War. And Eric Foner has written many books on slavery and Lincoln and the Civil War. Tony Horowitz's book is right there. It's about John Brown. Thomas Piketty wrote a book about capital, a new book about capitalism. And Harold Woodman wrote a book about King Cotton and his retainers. It's about about Cotton. Next. And then I went to the Chicago History Museum Library, Newberry Library, Chicago Public Library, Microfilm, and the Cotton Museum, and the DuSable Museum of African American History in Chicago. And these are we went through.
Okay, so you're
pretty much done. Yeah.
Let's thank Dan for his presentation and get ready for commercials.
Thank you.
I have a question.
Yes.
Yes. Well, Rob has to recognize
Doug
me.
First, and then Mike.
Oh. All right. You know, considering your expose on the evil of cotton, should we in 21st century America, should we embrace the cotton bowl? Because it's actually a physical structure and also the name of a football game played every New Year's Day. Is that? Should we be embarrassed by that? That's my question.
I don't have an answer.
All right, Mike.
You want to rename it?
I have a question about your table with the numbers, the monetary values. The numbers for capital invested in the different things, that was annual figures?
I think it was a census from 1860. So it was probably a year, right, annual or figure. 1 year.
Okay, and the figure that represented the slaves, well, what was that? How much the total amounts that were paid for them at auction, or was that the amount of money that was required to maintain the slaves, to feed them and house them and so forth?
I would guess that that's their worth. The worth that the bank would give collateral for.
Oh.
Or would give as collateral.
Okay. I just have one little question too about the decimation in the populations of the Caribbean natives.
Mm-hmm.
I read that the main reason for that was not killings, but
disease.
That the Spaniards worked them so hard that they didn't have the strength to procreate. As far as saying they were actually killed, I mean, I guess that's kind of killing off the race. But
well, it's killing by working too hard. Is that?
Basically, if you can't procreate, then you're
right.
Yeah, you're killing the race, I guess.
Right.
Let's see, Sid, then Carl.
Yeah, what do you think was the cause of the Civil War if you don't blame it on cotton or slavery?
I do blame it on cotton. Well, if I don't blame it on cotton or slavery, I think because the South attacked Fort Sumter.
Yeah, that's how it started.
Right. But why did they attack Fort Sumter? Because they thought maybe the North was going to take away slavery, or the North would fight,
the harbor.
Keep them, would try to keep the South as part of the country?
Carl and then Hal.
But in this museum there in Memphis, do they have anything about why they put cotton in like pill bottles and like how did they get started and is it necessary for like the pills and like should you keep the cotton in the pills?
Oh, cotton in the pill bottles. I think that's to absorb moisture. It's just to absorb moisture so the pills don't get wet.
I don't seem to see it that, like I used to.
Yeah, they don't do it anymore. It's true. I don't know why.
Other than the aspirin one.
Okay, yes. Let's see, Hal.
I read something on the internet. I don't know if it's true or not. But basically, there was a law passed in 1809 that says we could not import any more blacks from Africa.
Right, that's true.
So that means all the blacks here multiplied from here, I guess.
Right. Actually, it wasn't followed 100%.
Well, there was law
still
passed.
Right, the law was broken sometimes.
There was still slavery in Brazil, for instance.
They're bigger than us.
A vigorous slave trade, yes. Ted and then Bill.
How do you define capitalism?
Capitalism? I would say capitalism is when people get together and put money together and build a company.
If you have money to put it together.
Exploitation. All right, Bill.
Yeah, isn't this a grossly mistitled doc? Capitalism is a lot more capitalism than cotton.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was a big talk at one time. Okay. Pat, yes.
Yeah, slavery is often characterized as, a white man's sin against humanity. But would slavery have been possible if some of the blacks in Africa had not themselves been the ones who rounded up the slaves from the interior of Africa and sold them to the white slave traders at various treaty ports along the African coastline? Furthermore, were there not cases of free blacks who themselves ended up owning slaves and themselves supporting the Confederate agenda during the course of the Civil War?
Yes to your final question, and you're right to the first part of the question. That doesn't take into account what was happening here in this country.
What was happening here would not have been taking place if it were not for the collusion of the various gentlemen on the other side of the Atlantic and the African coastal towns.
That's true, but then why would Lincoln have to do the Emancipation Proclamation?
It's my understanding the reason for the Emancipation Proclamation was to deprive the South much needed labor when so much of the Southern men were off fighting the war.
Right. Well, also it was to make the North win the war because the slaves were joining the army, and so they were fighting against their former masters, quote unquote. So, I mean, in the final analysis, it's a perfect example of what was going on in the war. The war was the Northern capitalists trying to keep the country together because they wanted the market, they wanted that cheap cotton to go to the banks in London and New York and get a loan and make more money and get bigger and invest in the new oil business or invest in the new car business or invest in whatever business, new business, that they can make more money. This was not, this was part of the whole economy of the time. It wasn't just slavery in one little pocket and then cotton over here. But cotton was the whole country. It was the North benefiting just as much as the South, if not more. Yes,
Charlie? Wesley Clark, Wagner, couldn't one man
as many cotton plantations as he wanted to.
Sure.
And then wasn't his wealth measured by how many slaves he had?
I don't know about that. But probably. That sounds reasonable.
Okay, Wesley?
You identify a slave who have a slave certificate?
Pardon me?
How do you identify a slave? Do they have a slave certificate or a title?
No, title.
They had lists. They had owners had lists of who they owned and who they didn't own. And there were slave. I think at auction they would have slave lists.
There were some on the table.
People for sale.
Some were branded, weren't they?
Huh?
Weren't some branded?
Some branded. Yeah, they had chains around them and things like that.
They also had something called.
Not always. Not all slaves.
Charlie.
Yeah, Dan. Does religion and Christianity in particular authorize violence? I mean, John Brown read his Bible and then he went off killing, and then the Muslim guy reads his Quran, he goes out killing. So is all this authorized by religious scriptures?
You'd have to ask a religious person, I'm not sure. But I know there is a lot of violence in the Bible. And there's just a lot of violence in the Bible. I don't know about
that. All right, let's put it another way. Do you think John Brown was authorized in wanting to arm slaves and kill their masters?
I think he had a mission, and he was on a mission, and I think he was very strong in what he believed, and just as strong as Lincoln was when he did the Emancipation Proclamation, or maybe John Brown was stronger in his belief than Lincoln was.
Well, Lincoln didn't say kill the slave owners.
No, but he went to war to kill them who were killing the North and South. So it was, in a way, he did say kill the slave owners.
Yes.
I think.
All right. Pat Butler and Jonathan Bart.
Yes, sir. Getting back to the business of Lincoln and killing. Didn't Lincoln say shortly before the Civil War, if I could save the Union by freeing the slaves, I would do it. If I could save the Union by freeing some of the slaves and not others, I would do it. And if I could save the Union by leaving them in slavery, I would do it.
Right.
So wasn't Lincoln's main focus being keeping the United States intact,
yes,
rather than freeing the slaves?
Oh, sure. I agree with you. Yes. And like I said that the main reason for the Civil War was not slavery, not at all. And they didn't get freed until 2 years later, after the start of the Civil War. So the purpose of the Civil War was to keep cheap cotton going to the ports and the banks of New York so they could make money. And they didn't want the nasty South to go away and start another country, and then they might have banks in Atlanta, Georgia, or Birmingham, Alabama, or Florida, and the banks there never got big. There were small banks. So they went to the New York banks, and they used the New York banks and the London banks. So what you said, what I was getting off the point, Lincoln was, in that statement, he wasn't a big emancipator, but he eventually became one, mainly, I think, because the blacks would fight on the Union side and not on the Confederate side.
Hey, Jonathan?
Yeah, I'm fascinated about the nature of the relationship between Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln. Could you go deeper into giving analysis of that advising that Frederick Douglass gave to Lincoln? Obviously, he wasn't a cabinet member, but he was in strong correspondence with Lincoln.
Right. I'm not really familiar with that, but I would imagine that, like what I'm saying, Douglas would say something like that, that Douglas would say that the blacks could fight on the Union side and not on the Confederate side, or be neutral and just not fight. So look, Abraham, you know, look, these guys can fight for you. They'll have a gun and they'll shoot the gray coats. So, I mean, I think that's what would happen. I think that's what was said.
They were already recruited.
Yeah. Wow, so good.
And they would become free if, once they became part of the army. But they had to become part of the army first, and then they would be free automatically.
All right, Bill Webb.
I'm Rob.
Are you all familiar with The Real Lincoln by Thomas D. Lorenzo?
No.
That sense.
I know about Eric Foner. He wrote a book about, a very recent book about Lincoln, all about Lincoln and all about slavery and Lincoln and the Civil War, et cetera, et cetera. I want to read that, I think. Eric Foner, F-O-N-E-R.
Are you not familiar with the 1863 New York draft riots?
Yes, I am a little bit. And they were mostly anti-black riots. They were, right? Because, rich white people could get out of the draft by giving $300 to whoever, their alderman or whatever, and they wouldn't be drafted into the Civil War. So, actually, it ended up blacks were getting murdered. They would have to hire a substitute. Okay, they had money. But then poor people, poor white people, got stuck going in the army. And so they went, you know, it's like the same time, you know, same old story. But also what happened, as a side light, they started killing African Americans. And there was a lot of that before the early part of this country, actually. Right, Sid?
No more questions. James, do you have a question? No?
Okay.
I'll
ask a question.
Elder.
In reference to an earlier question as to, you know, would there be slavery in America if the tribesmen in Africa weren't selling slaves? Well, you need a market to sell something, so there was a market in the United States, so I'm wondering if that wasn't the connection.
Right. And there were, so... You're saying that if Arabs or Chinese people went to Africa and got slaves, they would have to go back to China and have a market for slaves. So there was no market. So it was capitalism. It was a cooperational thing. I think that's true.
Can I have some water, please?
All right, Charles.
Yeah, Dan, your basic premise is the business of cotton had no relationship to the North in any way, shape, or form. It had no, outside of the few mills perhaps in New England, impact on the economy, or the lives, or anything for the people living in the North.
No, wrong. I said they invested, they put their money into New York banks, London banks. So that was a big part of the North.
It looks like they had more money in England than they did in the States.
Oh, maybe they did. London was the center of banking.
I mean, there was no connection between the economies. I don't see a real connection between the economies of the North and the economies of the South.
Charlie, then you haven't been listening.
As if cotton was a process, was a ship, it seems to be. It had more shipping overseas.
It had a lot of shipping overseas. Well,
established it was more important to England than the North, right?
No, I said...
Your own slides seem to indicate.
I don't think so. I think you're missing the point that money from... from the sale of cotton went into New York banks like Barings and Brooks Brothers. Brooks Brothers, they got rich. These were New York people. And so I don't see where you get, the North got rich from cotton. The government was supported by exports, by stuff going to England. The government took export taxes, and they made a lot of money from export taxes. So, anyway.
Okay, let's get into rebuttals, okay? Right.
Are we ready for rebuttals?
Thank you, and you, of course, Dan, you get the last rebuttal. So listen closely. All right, how many here have a few remarks to make on the subject? Or preferably on the subject of whatever is important to you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, at least 7. How much time do we have, Dan?
We got about maybe how many people around?
We have.
Go about 4 minutes each.
Yeah, there's a few things that are happening. The latest statistic is that there's 62 people in the world that own half the wealth of the planet. That's the latest statistic. That's what capitalism has wrought. Another thing, 93% of all the profit made by capital goes into capitalist hands, the 1%. And the rest gets 7%. So that's how marvelous capitalism is.
Somebody just went out there and grabbed the power.
As far as the Civil War, I think mainly it was fought over the territories. When you grow, when you have a monocrop like cotton,
I didn't even get any water. You know.
After a while,
there's water.
No,
the soil. The soil isn't able to produce correctly. It's not fertile, and you have to move the crop. They say every 7 years crops have to be moved. You can't have the same crop grown over and over and over again. So what happened was you had the territories, Wyoming and Nebraska and the rest of the territories, and the South wanted to move cotton to the territories, where the northern capitalists said, no, we want to have those territories for something else. So I think that's one of the basic reasons for the war. As far as Lincoln is concerned, he first started out, he wasn't against slavery, and they gave the reasons there. But after a while, he realized that slavery was not only non-human, but it was also deleterious to the capitalist system in general, because it wouldn't allow it to develop its full capacity to industrialization. And the capitalist world is based on industrialization. It's based on exploitation of workers, and that's how it makes its profit. So all in all, capitalism looks for the biggest profit it could possibly get. It gravitates toward the profit is the highest. Always does that. And if you look into imperialism that we have today, that's why it gravitates to other countries in the world, because the profit margin is so much better. It's a form of super exploitation. And the super exploitation during certain periods, like for instance, right before the war and after the war, let's say from about 1933 when Roosevelt got in to about 1970, the economy was good because of the super exploitation
it was able to pay off a large percentage of the workers, and the workers said, well, capitalism is great. Look at all the money we're making. It wasn't great for everybody. It wasn't great for minorities, Mexicans and blacks and so forth. But for white workers, it was great. And they have the idea that's the way capitalism works. But if you look beyond that point of view, to the point of view during the First World, before the First World War, and up until, like I said, about 1933 and after that, capitalism was terrible. You had the United in Chicago here in 1871. They had the Haymarket riots because people were being worked to death and they weren't given much of the compensation for the work. There was super exploitation here. So in order to mollify the workers, you have to have imperialism. That's what imperialism is for, to a certain degree, for super profits.
You're out of time, Sid. Next, please.
The talk was, had a lot of very interesting elements. Just wanted to touch on two things. To say that capitalism is bad or was bad and is still bad, I mean, capitalism is not bad or good. It's just what it was. It is what it is. Under capitalism, the majority of people lived in nominal freedom. In what preceded capitalism, feudalism, okay, where the vast majority of people lived in a, at least like a semi-bondage. You had the right to buy your freedom, but very few people were able to buy their freedom under feudalism, whereas the majority of Americans, and slavery is a terrible thing, and it has nothing to do really with capitalism as such, though. It has to do with even pre-feudalism. So it was a messy situation. But to say that capitalism was bad, is bad, would you prefer the warlord type of society where you have Attila the Hun and maybe Attila the Hun gets overthrown and you get some other warlord? You know, capitalism was vastly superior and it was a progressive force. And it took us, feudalism took us away from the warlord thing and capitalism took us away from feudalism, and so it was good. On reparations, I have to say, I don't know if I'm for reparations or not, but if we're gonna have reparations, as someone with some Jewish blood, okay, I need to get some reparations from Egypt, okay? And the guy across the alley from me, he's Polish, okay? So he's got to get his reparations from Italy because they're the descendants of the Romans. So I have to say, I am for reparations, but you have to you have to give anyone who's due reparations, you have to go beyond the descendants of African slaves and give it to the descendants of Jewish former Jewish slaves and Slavic people. The word Slavic is from slave. They were enslaved by the Romans. So, you know, let's
the Turks.
Yeah, well, we can go on and on.
Thank you.
Next.
Thanks, Dan, for the interesting talk. I tend to agree to a large extent with the last gentleman on what he said about capitalism. I asked you what capitalism was, and you said basically it's people getting together and building companies, making a company. I'm not an economist, but it seems to me that it's something having to do with the accumulation of money and investing, and also the existence of private property. And I think that's fairly neutral in and of itself. I don't believe that it's necessarily exploitative, or certainly not ridiculously exploitative. So I think that what needs to be done, instead of all this talk about demonizing capitalism and blaming everything on capitalism, including Indians being dispossessed, referring to your talk, the Civil War, you refer to conquistadors and child labor. I mean, everything under the sun, is, according to this kind of thinking, is the fault of capitalism. I disagree. So I think we have to control capitalism for sure. We have to, and we have to decide all of us together whether we should even have it at all or have something else. But I wouldn't demonize capitalism as such. Well, I think the problems that we have are essentially due to people, ordinary people, not having control. You have, so the problem I might say is capitalists, not capitalism. So you have capitalists with the big money controlling government. So, but we can have government and capitalism without necessarily capitalists being in the driver's seat. So I think that we should ask, who is the government? And if it's capitalists who make up the government or who control the quote-unquote representatives, then we have to fix that or replace that kind of system. So we have to focus a whole lot more on the kind of government that we have, rather than demonizing capitalism, ad infinitum. Thanks.
Okay, next, Bill, are you going?
Yes. My great-grandfather was sometimes a general, retired as a colonel of the Union Army. He was a Zouave, and he led, during the draft riots in New York, he led troops from Governor's Island up to the armory where the commandant of New York was imprisoned by a mob of mostly Irish stevedores who were also doing damage to the Negro orphanage and the local sheriff, and people were hung from lampposts in New York, who were unfortunately for them black by these rioting. You see, the Irish in had emigrated to the New World, to the United States, so that they did not have to go to London or to Britain, Manchester, where they were called blacklegs, strikebreakers, scabs, because they were the poor non-English who were trying to get themselves a job. So they came to the United States, and the blacks in New York broke their strike, or tried to break their strike on the docks, where they were trying to get decent wages. So they had no, and they were being drafted, yes. They were being drafted into the army, even if they weren't American citizens. And where they were still drafted. So they hated blacks, and they hated the idea of being drafted, and they hated being abused and run and told that no Irish need apply. They built up Tammany as Tammany became an Irish, and the police department became an Irish bulwark in Manhattan. Anyway, my grandfather, the only time he ever shot anybody that he saw face to face and remembered it was when he came up to the commandant of the Port of New York, imprisoned in this armory, and a man charged from the crowd with a knife and was about to stab him, and he shot him. My great-grandfather shot him point blank. Otherwise, my great-grandfather was a Union general and made the fastest cavalry advance of the Civil War or perhaps cavalry history. Anyway, what does that have to do with capitalism?
It's a
people were making money out of cotton and slavery. It was big business in New York, in Baltimore, in all in Boston. Money is impersonal. It's people can clean their hands, and they don't have to see the weeping of slaves and abused people.
Five minutes.
Yeah,
it's
fine.
But
slavery was
time.
Very real, and it was enforced time. By American capitalism. I want to follow the old tradition here, came under tradition of a pre-prepared rebuttal. I looked at the announcement and the curriculum, and I had a book, A Capitalist View, A Theory of Capitalism. Well, it's by a British Marxist. I've got it out in the car here. I read part of the introduction of that, you know, it was about how much the government had to do with the establishment of capitalism. And I was going to, you know, whenever you talk about this very narrow section of capitalism, the cotton trade, you know, I mean, yeah, it wasn't a free enterprise. It wasn't free arms-length exchange. Somebody had a club over somebody else's head to gain an advantage. And that's not my idea of capitalism. Now, I hate to be eclectic, it may sound like I'm a little disorganized, but one thing I do think found very significant, the student of draft laws, that was against the draft, but actually the writers were afraid of competition in the labor markets for freed slaves. And there was kind of a picket line. There was a book that came out about 10 years ago, Brad Chester doing the devil's work, and Thomas D. Lorenzo, the real Lincoln, a quote, a British consul official was saying, that's what the writers were telling him, and he was observing this. D. Lorenzo, I mean, what did he think of? I've read that book. I think he kind of overdoes it about Lincoln. But he does lay out, I think it's the first thing I've ever seen laid out, Henry Clay's Henry System, American System, which consisted of high tariffs, what he called, and then internal improvements, so he would call public works, and paper money. That's kind of an osmosis in microcosm. But what we have to do, and it shows back then, it was how significant these institutions are in concentrating wealth. I think what I see about capitalism is not that the rich get richer under a per capitalism, but under a government imposed capitalism. Rich do get richer, and the poor get poorer. Well, not necessarily. Sometimes there's a little increase in wealth, because Tim's going to say something about that. But it's not as it ought to be. I'd like to say that my skeletal outline of economic reality is always war is peace in 1984. About wars directly fought to dissipate capital, keep people poor. Not to win anything, but this sounds an awful lot like a Vietnam War, although it didn't explain exactly where this war was going to be fought. But he said somewhere in the river of the Pacific Ocean, which I guess is close enough.
Okay.
Very good, man. Very good.
All right. I'm next. I'm going to go next.
All right.
Go. Hang on. I'm waiting for Bill here.
I want to ask you guys right now, how many of you are wearing cotton shirts tonight?
I probably am.
Yeah.
How many of you are wearing like a cotton t-shirt or some type of cotton underwear?
Capitalist produced.
We're all capitalists.
Don't ask me to prove it. Bad capitalist.
That ought to tell you something right now, because when cotton first came around, it was a miracle fabric.
That's right.
And it was probably the first commodity that was traded on a global basis. Yes, there was a lot of evil associated with slavery and other types of things, but you know, generally cotton made us a lot more comfortable with fabric. It was the first tradable commodity, and we also had several of them later on. One of the funny things about cotton was the invention of the telegraph and the transcontinental cable. How many of you have ever heard of a gentleman by the name of Mason Wirth? He was actually a Paris dress designer. And he used to make those big dresses that the women used to wear for the courts of Europe. And of course, the southern plantation owners. His brother was one of the first people to take orders via telegraph and ship them overseas, so that the southern plantation girls could have the latest Paris fashions, the people in Russia could have the latest things. In other words, it was cotton, the development of dye fabric, and the proclivity of women's fashion that really started the globalization and industrial revolution of right around 1865. Your first global trade for what we would consider modern day shipping and order taking, and the invention of the bill of lading in a modern form, where they would take in a certain item to a customer, take an order, have it transferred via have the money transferred via telegraph, was done by the empire that Mason Wirth's brother had provided. And for many women, it enriched their lives. Capitalism is not an evil thing. It is a system of economic exchange that allows people to operate in the markets. It fills the needs of a marketplace. If there's a demand for, let's say, drugs or illegal drugs, somebody is going to fill that market because of the profit motive. If there's a demand for more rayon and polyester than there is cotton, some company will come and fill a need for it. If there's a demand for oil, some people will fill a need for it, and you can tell that by the pricing mechanism that's provided. If the price is low, it's not produced as much. If the price is high, it's produced more. Where we have the problem is when government tries to interfere with the markets. When the government tries to regulate the markets through trade and tariff. Companies go grow, and they go bankrupt. You also need to not only have the creative, the acclimation and industrialization and creation of companies, but also the dissolution of companies through bankruptcy. Today we kind of have a crazy system. Wall Street enjoys all the gains but doesn't take responsibility for the losses. That's why we're having a recession. That's why we're not doing a lot of what we're doing. We don't allow the system of capitalism to freely operate because we have too much government interjection in the free market system.
Time.
Yay! That's right. It's striking how much capitalism resembles a cancer cell and how it operates throughout history. And it adapts its oppression to different eras. Yeah, it's true the most extreme and fanatical form of physical slavery was abolished in this country. We still have financial wage slavery, educational slavery, housing slavery, healthcare slavery, environmental slavery, police brutality slavery, and the worst, which we're about to feel the empire's lash come out at all of us with the most vengeance, is the Trans-Pacific Partnership trade slavery. 60 years ago, Edward R. Murrow said, "We will not be driven by fear into an age of unreason if we remember that we are not descended from fearful people. We're not descended from people who feared to write, to speak, to associate, and defend causes which were for the moment unpopular." Now we can adapt that to now. Who's it unpopular with to oppose the Trans-Pacific Partnership? Well, if you talk to somebody like Tim Geithner or Larry Summers or Rahm Emanuel, or any candidate for a Republican position, either local, state, or federal in the United States, that's unpopular with them. But if you go to working class communities where the descendants that were lucky enough to survive the transatlantic slave trade are working service jobs making between $11,000 and $13,000 a year, that's not an unpopular position to take at all, to oppose trade policies that pretty much make us non-entities in the 21st century. I just want to say, when I think about people like Eric Garner and Sandra Bland and Rekia Boyd and Laquan McDonald and Mike Brown and Trayvon Martin and many, many others whose names we'll never know, I think about this quote by Henry Wallace 70 years ago. "They claim to be super patriots, but they would destroy every liberty that's guaranteed. They demand free enterprise, but are the spokespeople for monopoly invested interests, and their final objective towards which all their deceit is directed is the capture political power, so that using the power of the state and the market simultaneously, they'll keep the working communities in eternal slavery." We are not descendants from fearful people, and the sky's the limit if we just have solidarity, what we can do to make the unpopular voices finally popular in this 21st century of a new dawn of we the people-ism, we the people-volution, and just we the people values in general. I think that's what all of us in this room and all across the country are looking for, is to say we haven't abolished just one aspect of slavery, but all.
Butler.
All right, Pat.
Got some water?
Sure.
You know, we hear a lot here tonight and most other nights when the College of Complexes is in session on the idea that capitalism is the great boogeyman of the world and that it tyrannizes all of us. I would be curious to see if that would be the case if capitalism, true capitalism, were actually tried in this country. What we have now is not a capitalistic system. Not when you have a small handful of people controlling the wealth of this country and calling it free market capitalism. Yeah. It is not free market capitalism. It is an oligarchy, plain and simple. Yeah. And if we're going to have that form of tyranny, I think we should at least have the trappings and ceremony and stuff that goes along with that kind of thing. We were talking earlier, I'm not going to talk about Queens. We've already heard earlier about getting out of the age of warlords. You know what yesterday's warlords are? Today's royal family. I have a friend who is a distant relative of a branch of the British royal family. And she once told me, because we compared our family histories, and she once told me, "Pat, the only difference between your family and my family was that we were better bandits than yours." And that's probably true. But the point of the matter is, you know, we like to put these labels on things, and we like to wave banners in favor of free market capitalism or God knows what else, in most cases not even knowing what we're talking about and what we're going to get. Now, every time Donald Trump opens his mouth, his numbers go up. And I keep hearing from people, oh, don't worry. There's no way that idiot is going to get elected president of the United States. And my uncle, who was a kid in the late 1930s, he and other people used to joke about this house painter turned politician, postcard painter turned politician, named Adolf Hitler, who wasn't even a German, he was an Austrian. And the attitude in the United States was, oh, the Germans are sensible people. They'll never elect a nut like that. And sure enough, what happened? The nut got elected. Now, we in the United States, and Hitler was legally elected Chancellor of Germany. In the United States, we have a very, very interesting election coming up. It's in what level a case of Tweedledee-Dee and Tweedledee-Dum, because none of them really stands out. It isn't a question of where we have the makings of a Franklin Roosevelt or a Teddy Roosevelt or a Winston Churchill out there. Whoever gets elected president this time around, if we're lucky, will be very mediocre. If we are not lucky, they will be a committed tyrant. Just I think it will trump all others. And you know, we can't laugh at this guy anymore. In the very beginning, I was rolling in the aisles. I no longer do, because I'm afraid I, like most people in this room, know too much history to do that anymore. We know what can happen.
Okay.
Moving on.
Time.
Is it time?
No, 4 minutes.
No, no. Yeah.
Well,
minute.
Being a good American citizen,
all right.
I yield to the next.
Okay. Andy, 4 minutes.
I'll talk to you later.
Okay, I'll try to hit a couple points. That
was your final thing. Question.
Was that Pat? Pat was just giving that presentation just now. He hit the nail right on the head. We haven't tried capitalism where workers have equal rights in this country. There's a bread factory that was on the news lately where the workers, it's a co-op where they own the factory, and they show pictures of a worker on an assembly line making bread that he makes $62,000 a year plus benefits and everything else, a truly living wage. If workers actually shared the fruits of their labors, you would have living wages. There's a few points I'd like to make in the 4 minutes I have. Number one, Tom Hartman, we're in the middle of a weird election cycle. I keep thinking back to James Kirk, Captain Kirk from the Starship Enterprise, saying, we're going where no man has gone before. And that's where we are today with this election. The Stephanie Miller Show and the comedians say they in their wildest dreams they wouldn't think we would have a Comedy Central election again until Sarah Palin threw her hat in the ring with Donald Trump. I mean, we're living in truly amazing times. And as I've said in all of my speeches, Censored News points out how the media maintains us in a bubble of ignorance and mythology. People think that we've had Republicans elected to president in honest elections. Tom Hartman, is the historian, has made it very, very clear, vividly clear, that no Republican has gained the White House since Dwight D. Eisenhower. There's not been a Republican elected since Eisenhower installed in the White House without massive treason and criminality against the people of the United States. Every Republican since Eisenhower has been gotten control of the White House with massive treason. And George Bush, with Dick Cheney, they weren't even elected. They stole the first election with the Supreme Court, and then they stole the second one by switching the vote totals, just flipping the totals from 47% to 53% in favor of the opposition. They say, well, Bush got it 53% to 47%. They just flipped the totals in 11 states after we went to bed. That's where we are. The billionaires, somebody said 62 people own half the wealth of the planet. We're running a welfare for billionaires program unlike anything the world has seen. You have to go back to the time of the pharaohs before you could find wealth disparity like what we have today. Our country is producing, we have a massive number of people that are slaves without the ball and chain around their ankle. All you have to do is go into a Walmart store and interview the workers. That's as close to economic slavery as you can get in a so-called free society. These people have no freedom. They're working two or three jobs to try to assemble enough money to live indoors. Our country is unique also. We are number one in throwing an economic ball and chain, locking it around the ankles of our young people, students coming out of college. We're producing an army of slaves that are slaves to the bank with their student debt. These kids have no freedom. They can't invest or buy a home or get on with their life. They're going to be in debt for 25 years. That's where we are today. And we have to wake up and take a look and face the reality of these things. A good place to start, the last thing I'll mention is, for all of you that have internet access, you can learn about all these things on a website called Common Dreams. commondreams.org. They post the best of the best news on all these things we're talking about every day. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Is that understandable?
Who else is going to be a rebuttal? Charlie, go ahead. 4 minutes, Charlie.
You want to go?
Oh, no, I've been.
All right, let's thank our speaker.
Thank you. You put a lot of time and effort into this. Thank you for your bells helping you out. I'll be eclectic as usual here. I was initially here in the early part of the evening. Friend Mike here gave us a choice. You know, I mean, the next time I talk to the workers, you know, they represent, you know, they might complain about their boss, but I could say, hey, it's a lot better than working for having a warlord in charge. That's called a false choice. Oh, capitalism isn't bad. You could be under the control of a warlord. I never thought about it that way. Is it that bad now that I think about it?
You're welcome,
see,
Chuck. You're welcome.
The other thing is, I've actually had a lot of occasion to spend a lot of time in Harper's Ferry where John Brown was operating. I often get off the train on the way to Washington. He would spend a day, two or three there. It's an interesting town with a lot of Civil War history. It's a confluence of rivers like a Pittsburgh. It was exchanged at least half a dozen times during the course of the Civil War. And of course, John Brown was going to take it. It was an arsenal for the United States military. And he was going to gain weapons there and lead an insurrection of slaves. Now, the one thing that the Southerners feared more so than anything else was a slave insurrection. I've actually written about this, but they're actually, what the amazing thing is, you did talk about what took place in the French Islands, but even though this is the amazing thing, even though there really were no true incidences of slave insurrections having taken place, it still fed the whole operations of the South. And it'd be somewhat similar to this concept we have of this terrorism. I mean, we do have real incidences of terrorism taking place, but they really didn't have, as a matter of fact, the insurrections, I think the largest insurrection in the United States by slaves were 8 slaves. So that's what I mean. They never got going. They never had any momentum. Nevertheless, they acted totally in fear of this. Now along comes John Brown, and he's got religion behind him, the religious theology, and he was going to have big pikes and go. Now the other thing that's interesting about John Brown, if you go to Harper's Ferry, there is a monument, not to John Brown, but to the guy who turned him in and rang the alarm. And that was a black guy. And it's caused some controversy because this monument was put up by the daughters of the Confederacy. Honoring a black guy who turned in the guy who was trying to get them free, but he worked for the B&O Railroad. And another thing you hit on here, I'll switch a little bit, you hit a little bit, just a little bit there on Dred Scott. And a lot of people don't understand what happened in Dred Scott. It was the trial in St. Louis about the guy who transported a slave from free to slave territory. And the reason the decision had nothing to do with transporting an individual, and you did kind of hit on this, you did, was the fact that the employer was denied the work of the individual. That's what that case decided. And they used to think about this, are you denied the work like that? Anyhow, he's telling me my time is up. Thank you very much. You know, come again when you got another one in you. I appreciated that. You know, I never got to yap about capitalism.
Okay.
But you think it's okay.
Okay. Final remarks, Dan?
And what are you going to vote for?
Thank you. This thing's
Trump, Cruz, and Rubio, man.
Say Butler.
Trump. Capitalism is not the evil. It's what people do with capitalism, and. Dred Scott, I didn't talk about Dred Scott, but it said that blacks cannot be a citizen of the United States. That's what I thought it said. But I'm not a lawyer, so I won't go into that. Anyways, thanks for your questions, and thanks again.
Do a quick Google of Common Dreams, will you? See what comes up, see what the headline is right now. CommonDreams.org.
Charlie, next week is in Carina or?
Yeah. Oh, Bloomberg.
Carina on Mouth.
Bloomberg is having a presidential party.